for lively conversation and debate on the issues that concern you. Gary may not agree with you, but he's never disagreeable. It's your show, your thoughts, your ideas. You'll be entertained. And if not careful, educated. Exclusively on Rejoice 101.3 FM, 990 AM, and on the web at rejoice990.com. The Gary Flowers Show starts now.
Welcome to the Gary Flowers Show and happy Thursday. August the 16th, 2018, and I am broadcasting, we are broadcasting from the WREJ studios just west of Richmond. But this morning I want to introduce to some and present to others Jeanne Frazer. She's the president of Vitalink and a founding partner of a company entitled HBCUgrow. As you know, I'm a very, very, very ardent supporter of HBCUs, both from a family perspective and from the perspective that the value added that HBCUs bring to the American higher education landscape. So, Sister Jeanne, welcome to the Gary Flowers Show.
Thank you so much. I am so happy to be here this morning.
Yes, I'm glad that you're calling. And you're calling in from North Carolina, I believe, right?
Yes, I am, from Raleigh.
From Raleigh. I love Raleigh. Raleigh is a beautiful city in the triangle there.
Yes.
And so tell me a little bit more about your background. Where did you grow up, and how did you become a lover of education?
Well, I grew up, and my mother actually had dropped out of school to get married, which was sort of familiar for that time. And when I was around in kindergarten age, she went back to school. Now, I think she struggled with school when she was of the age that she was in college. And had she not dropped out to get married, she was struggling to stay in school. When she went back to school when I was in kindergarten, she had a different approach to it. And she ended up graduating second in her class, which made me so proud of her. And my mother became a teacher and spent her life as a teacher. And I think that that really gave me a love and an importance of education and what you can do if you put your mind to it. And grew up outside Philadelphia, and then I've also lived in Kentucky and then spent some years in Florida going to high school and college there.
Okay.
So education has
always been a central theme in your life.
Yes.
Well, now, I did my homework, and I know that you are a co-founder or partner of HBCUgrow and president of Vitalink. And when I looked at your photograph, I couldn't help but notice that you're white. Now, in saying that, I'm saying this tongue in cheek. How did a white lady become such an ardent supporter of black colleges?
I was introduced to HBCUs, it was in the early 2000s, and I felt like I found a home. I found something so special when I was introduced to HBCUs, with the culture and the nurturing and the family atmosphere, and some of those things that I felt like I'd missed. And I also saw that HBCUs were struggling in some senses, and it just felt like that couldn't happen. They're too important to the number of people that they educate, and, you know, members of Congress, lawyers, judges, in the scientific community. It's just too important. And at that point, I kind of knew I had a choice.
Well,
and my choice
let me commend
was
you
I could
there.
Sit back and do...
Go ahead. Your choice
I'm
was
sorry?
What?
I could do nothing, or I could take action, and I could help. And I chose to step up and help and be part of the solution.
Well, kudos to you. For two reasons. And you mentioned a phrase twice, that HBCUs are too important to the American higher education landscape. And whether you're white or black or of any other ethnicity, to value HBCUs is very, very important, particularly in this day and time. But it didn't just start recently, the question of HBCU relevance. I remember my father, may he rest in peace, talking, you know, very passionately about the idea that in the 1940s, Virginia Tech, it was said that the Virginia General Assembly was going to allow Virginia Tech to take over Virginia State College and make it a campus of Virginia Tech. And there has always been a fight for the independence of HBCUs. If you look at the numbers, the, you know, the physicians, black physicians in this country, for the most part, come from HBCUs. The black engineers, for the most part, come from HBCUs. And there is a value-added proposition to their existence. But tell us more about HBCU Grow and how that helps black colleges and universities.
Okay. Well, HBCU Grow, we wanted to build it as a community where we would share knowledge and best practices and make sure that HBCUs have the access to all those things that can help them grow. That includes a conference that we hold. Mm-hmm. So the conference, we've got one coming up this November 15th in the Charlotte area, and we have sessions on all those types of things that are going to help keep HBCUs healthy and sustainable. And some of that includes student life cycles, where they'll get to see what kind of checkpoints you have to make sure that you can help with retention of students, which helps people graduate. It helps keep HBCUs bringing revenue in and doing what their core job is to do, which is educate students. There's a student recruiting panel, because that's a huge part. HBCUs rely on enrollment a lot of times for their livelihood.
Absolutely.
But that model alone for their livelihood is not enough. So then we also have a panel on the role of alumni in fundraising, because I think if we can kind of step up how HBCUs raise their funds, then they can become sustainable, whether you have a dip in enrollment 1 year or a growth in enrollment, that we get to the point where we're able to bring more resources to these colleges that are so important. We also have a digital impact panel, because right now these days, if you're not like you guys are with your podcast and streaming, if you're not on the web and you're not speaking in the language of today's millennials and younger generation, then you're just simply not going to reach them.
Exactly.
We also have a presidential panel, because we feel like leadership is really important. And that's one of the things that can be tough, because at HBCUs, you see more changes in leadership than PWIs. And that can make it tough for
Tell the voices of the village what a PWI is.
A PWI is basically a primarily, predominantly white institution.
Got it. Just want to make sure people knew the acronyms. So if you can and will, why don't you stay with us through the break? And when we return, I want you to talk more about the conference and how people can connect to HBCU Grow, but more importantly, some of the statistics around support of HBCUs around the country. Agreed?
Agreed.
All right. I look forward to talking to you more just after the commercial break. In tribute to HBCUs, this is the alma mater of Virginia State University. High above the Appomattox is how it begins. Hail State, hail State, hail, hail, hail. Are your loyal sons. Welcome back to the Gary Flowers Show. As we pay tribute to HBCUs this morning, we have on the line Jeanne Frazer, who is the co-founder of HBCU Grow, a company that looks at how to market and assist HBCUs in their growth and development. She's also president of VitaLink. Before we talk to her, just received sad news that we may have seen coming in the last 3 or 4 days. The Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin, has made her transition. May she rest in peace and power. She, not just for her voice, but she has been a transformational figure in American history. Born of the Reverend C.L. Franklin and his wife in Detroit, Michigan, raised in the church to sing church hymns. It was her courage and her fortitude to break away from the sacred and attempt to sing secular songs. When she first emerged, her first two or three albums didn't do well because she had not found herself. She was trying to be a Nancy Wilson before she knew she was the Queen of Soul. And she was sent to Muscle Shoals, Alabama. And ironically enough, a white blues band under the direction of the founder of Muscle Shoals Studio backed her up, and that's when she found herself. And what an American story, that your father wants you to be one thing, and yet in your spirit there's something else. And Reverend Franklin ultimately supported and still adored his daughter Aretha as she became the Queen of Soul. She was respected by presidents and prime ministers. She was hailed around the world. And she elevated soul music to not just dance music, but a music with a message. When you hear the song, you better think. Or when you hear the song, Do Right, Woman. Those are messages to society. And for that, we say thank you, Ms. Aretha Franklin, for your life and your legacy. And may you rest in peace and power. With that, we get back to Sister Jeanne Frazer. And tell us more in the context of the value of HBCUs, not only your conference that's coming up, but what are some of the statistics in terms of giving to HBCUs, both from individuals and state legislatures?
Okay, I would be happy to do that. First off, I just do want to say that I grew up with a being impacted very much by Miss Aretha Franklin, and I just have mad respect for her, and the world has lost a beautiful soul. Want to say it saddens my heart, but I know that she will be, she's in a good place. So I'll start there. So I've done a little more research and taken a look at the rate of giving at HBCUs, and you have a difference in giving overall with the endowments, which is money basically put away that keeps earning money so that it sustains and you're not always in a cycle of having to give. We're at about 1/8 the size of typical predominantly white institutions.
Say that statistic again, please.
Our foundations, HBCU foundations, are at 1/8 of the size of predominantly white institutions. So what you have is you have predominantly white institutions that are earning a lot of interest each year to be able to fund things, and they don't have to touch the principal because they have enough money given that money just keeps giving back to them year after year after year.
Yes.
And so what you find with HBCUs is they're having to constantly sort of run on that, turn that wheel and redo and redo and redo to keep getting more and more people giving each year. So building a foundation is big, but at the average levels of giving, depending on your source, your average giving is between 11 and 15%.
Wow. Say that again slowly.
11 to 15%. That's the national average of giving at HBCUs from their alumni. I talked to my contact at Grambling State University. They're on our advisory board. We have an amazing advisory board for HBCUgrow. And he said that Grambling in the past 2 years has gone from 3%, only 3%, which the two lowest schools are at 2%. That's Fayetteville State University and Texas Southern. Grambling 2 years ago was at 3%, and they've risen within 2 years to 10%. So they've got a lot of work to do, but they're on that job, and they're getting there, and they understand the importance. And we have Mr. Mark Newman, who's going to sit on our Role of Alumni and Fundraising panel at the conference, which I think is great. You have schools on the high end. The ones who were doing the best are Claflin University in South Carolina tops that list. They've topped it in 2013-14, 2014-15, and other years as well. And their giving has ranged around 47% to 50% of their alumni.
Wow.
Another one who's done well has been Spelman College in Georgia, and they're an all-women's school, and their giving has been around 39%.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so you start to get a sense of who's giving, but that giving back and kind of that at HBCUs, you have a lot of people who are coming in on financial aid, much more so than at your PWIs. So you've got people coming in who have some financial challenges, and it may be a little tougher because they've got student loans and everything else. But
sure.
I think it's really important to instill this culture of giving and paying it forward.
But before,
so most people who go to
Go ahead.
Yes.
Continue.
I was just going to say, most people who go to HBCUs, if they've been there on a scholarship because someone has helped them get there, and
yes.
It's not always the government. The government alone cannot do all of this because they keep cutting budgets. So we need help to be able to have enough scholarships so that people can attend.
Sure.
So
well,
if
you know,
those
growing
who
up,
received a scholarship can pay it forward, that's a big deal.
Growing up, I'd love to drive standard transmission cars or stick shift. And when you
yes.
learn to drive a stick shift, you have to have the delicate balance between releasing the clutch and pressing the gas
mm-hmm.
while shifting the gear. And that may
yes.
be a good metaphor for the plight of HBCUs. There has to be a pressing of the gas by HBCU alums to give more to their university. It's one thing to wear paraphernalia and hats and sweaters and have stickers on your car and so forth and talk about the pride that you have in your alma mater. But if you're not giving to your alma mater, then the stickers and the sweatshirts and the hats pale in comparison. But at the same time, there needs to be a value-added proposition by state legislatures. In most states that have HBCU state schools, the state legislature is woefully short in recognizing the value added of HBCUs by their appropriations. And
yes.
and then there's the double whammy if you're an HBCU private institution. Hampton University by far is the leading black HBCU private institution in the country in terms of endowment and so forth. But there was a political price to pay there. President Harvey, unlike most, the spirit of most HBCU presidents, was a hardcore Republican and supported Ronald Reagan when hardly any other black HBCU presidents did so. And for that, he was rewarded with funding, and the campus looks beautiful. But I see Hampton as more of an exception than the rule.
Mm-hmm.
For the most part, the black HBCUs that are private, the Virginia Union universities, and the the others around the country, St. Augustine's and Shaw and others, are not as lucky. And I'm glad
no.
that HBCU Grow exists. And I wish you all well for your conference coming up in November. How can people contact you?
They can go to our website, which is hbcugrow.com, or they can email us at info@hbcugrow.com. Now, we are offering for the conference, for those who would like to attend, to our some of the voices of the village, because
yes.
we understand, and I've heard and listened to some of the shows and realize, you know, you've got a very intelligent, you know, audience who is engaged.
Yes.
We'll offer a 20% discount, so you would just have to input the code Flowers as your discount for a 20% discount.
Well, look at
that. One other point I wanted to bring out too about the legislature. A lot of times I know HBCUs will get dinged if they reach across the aisle. So you talked about Hampton having a Republican leader. So I was talking with another HBCU president. I don't want to put her name out there to get her in trouble for talking. But she said when she looked back, Bush gave more to HBCUs than Obama did.
It's true.
So sometimes, even if you don't believe in philosophies, getting funding is important. So
well, I'll say that all skin
across the
yeah.
aisle.
Yeah, also reaching across the aisle, all skin folk ain't kin folk. So we have to take
yes,
that into
exactly.
account as well.
You do, absolutely.
Well, thank you so much, Sister Jeanne, for calling in. Do you have time for one more segment? Or do you have to go?
I do, yes.
Okay, why don't you stay on?
I want to,
if you're an HBCU graduate or a lover of HBCUs, please call in and ask questions of Ms. Jeanne Frazer. We'll be back in a few minutes on the Gary Flowers Show. WREJ, this is the alma mater of Norfolk State University here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Stay tuned. We'll be back in a few minutes. May the Queen of Soul rest in peace and in power. As we pay respect to historically black colleges and universities, by way of our call-in interview with Jeanne Frazer, who is the co-founder of a company entitled HBCUgrow. Their mission is to help HBCUs in all facets, from fundraising to marketing and the like. And I'm so glad that she's with us today. If you are a graduate of an HBCU or have an opinion on the growth and development of HBCUs, I would implore you to connect with HBCUgrow and, if possible, attend their conference coming up in Gastonia, North Carolina on November the 15th. But toward that end, Sister Jeanne, once again, welcome. Let's go to Voices of the Village.
Thank you.
Brother Reggie, did you have a question or concern for Sister Jeanne Frazer?
Yes, yes. Good morning, Ms. Frazer. Peace and blessing to you,
ma'am.
Good
morning, Reggie.
Well, it really troubles me, and first of all, we must say all hail the Queen. God bless the Queen. Every friend she may have transitioned ought to be an ancestor. All hail the Queen. What bothers me is that the European schools, when Michael Vick attended Virginia Tech and they went on their run, enrollment went up 30%, and that was the pilot down in Tidewater that did that story. It seems to me that our HBCUs, when it comes to the soft money of paraphernalia, being HBCU for life or the MEAC or the SWAC, we don't embrace sports. I'm not saying you had to put $10 million to a stadium, but how about when Snoop Dogg is on the Soul Train Award and he's sporting a Grambling T-shirt? That was $1 million for free advertisement for HBCU. When you have other individuals like Kid and Play that's down in North Carolina Central, he puts on a North Carolina Central jacket. Why is it, again, that it seems like it comes to sports that our HBCUs don't want to embrace selling paraphernalia, which money can be used to give back to the schools and help enrollment?
Do you have an opinion on that, Sister Jeanne?
I do. And, you know, I guess it's one example is, you know, Grambling. Grambling's got one of the longest histories of success in football.
And the band. Let's not forget the band.
Yeah, and
worldwide.
The band. Oh, my gosh. Let's talk about the band. That's amazing.
Back in the 60s, the first Super Bowl they played.
Let her talk.
Yeah.
I apologize.
There's a fine line. Yeah, there's a fine line between higher education institutions and sports. And I think sports can fund the higher education institutions, and it is important, and they're a critical part of the experience. But I think that some HBCUs may have a fear of not being taken seriously if they market too much of the sport end. There's a balance. I think that it needs to be included, absolutely, because it is a reason why some students will choose a school. You know, it's not always the smartest reason, but anything that gets them to the school, I'm okay with. So sports are important, and I think culturally with HBCUs, the tailgating and the rest of it, I think that's recognized on kind of the back end with the alums, but it's an important aspect of school, but you've got to balance that with feeling like you're being taken seriously for your academic rigor. So I agree with you, Brother Reggie, that it is something that's important and it's key, but I do believe we have to strike a balance with it.
And what's your thoughts about it? What you thought about Hampton leaving the MEAC and going to outside the HBCU?
Oh, gosh. You know, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. I don't know that I have an exact opinion on it. I'm sad to see them leave the MEAC because they bring a lot to it. And I'm not sure what motives were behind leaving, so I don't know that I can comment as much on that. And I'd rather have someone from their end talk about why.
Well, Sister Jeanne, if I may interject at this point, I think it was very clear, and I think President Harvey has been very transparent about the reason. It's money. And he said, by way of getting his athletes exposed to, you know, a larger conference with television rights, at the end of the day, it's money. And I'm not sure that in higher education, money should be the sole driving force behind, in this case, moving to another conference. I'm not sure how many Hamptonians or Hampton alums want to see Hampton play Davidson. As much as they want to see them play North Carolina A&T.
Or Howard.
Or Morgan. Because one of the beauties of HBCUs, and I pray that this is in your conference, is that the cultural familial history. When my goddaughter just enrolled in Hampton University, it's because her ancestors enrolled in Hampton Institute. And when she talks to, you know, her friend who's at Morgan and who's, you know, the stadium is named for his grandfather, or my buddy's son who's All-American at North Carolina A&T, his father, his grandfather sat in the Greensboro Four, there is a family connection. And it, when you interject money into family, things don't usually end well.
Well, I'd want to see it where we can make those HBCU conferences, MEAC, WAC, the rest of that, where we can make those stronger, where they're bringing that kind of revenue there.
And how do you think we can get there?
Gosh, you know, it's about getting the conferences out there larger. I mean, you didn't have a lot of movies previously that were made by African-Americans for African-Americans because you had some people saying, well, they won't make money. Well, guess what? I think we've seen now that they do. And so it's a matter of how do we elevate the levels of conference? There's a lot of good play and entertainment and the best halftimes and bands around that are going on within those conferences. So I think it may be just a touch of marketing and support for
the conferences. We're seeing a pendulum shift.
Help elevate.
I think we're seeing a pendulum shift. When you see Mike London, who was formerly Coach of the Year and national champion at University of Richmond, and then highly regarded as he became coach at University of Virginia. He is at Howard University now. And the Charlotte Panthers starting quarterback, Cam Newton's baby brother, is the starting quarterback at Howard. And when you look at that in relation to North Carolina A&T being national champions last year, that there is a pendulum shift toward young athletes, instead of going to Ohio State, going to Central State or Wilberforce. And I think that's a good thing. But speak specifically as to how HBCUgrow can help alums. And then once again, give out your contact information for HBCUgrow and for the conference coming up on November 15th.
Okay, so, you know, HBCUgrow, we've worked to help build the largest and the fastest growing HBCUs in the country. So it's important. And the thing is, HBCUs, in a sense, are fairly easy to market because they have so much good. And marketing is about marketing what's good to the right people. But there's maybe been a consistency or a message that hasn't been as on point as needed. So when you get out there with that message, it resonates and it works. So we can do an easy job with that. So HBCUgrow helps bring out all those pieces. So you can reach us. Our website is hbcugrow.com, or you can email us at info@hbcugrow. And, again, that conference, if you'd like to attend the conference, there's a 20% discount if you input the code FLOWERS for the Voices of the Village. And I will
thank
say
you for that.
One other thing that I'd want to ask the Voices of the Village, for our presidential panel, we're looking to fill a couple slots there. And I'd like some input on who you think would be the best president to sit on our presidential panel.
Well, and, you know, I would suggest two off the top.
The village to help hook us up with a good president for that panel.
I would suggest two off the top. Dr. Hakeem Lucas at Virginia Union University has a very keen relationship to students, as does Dr. Makola Abdullah at Virginia State University. Both are very well attuned to students, their language, their values, and their needs. And so I would suggest those two off the top. But if there are HBCU alums who are listening and viewing, please call in and suggest a president that you may see on the panel at the HBCU Grow Conference on November the 15th. The toll-free line is open at 877-953-3990 or 804-788-0990. And I'll say to you, Sister Jeanne, and this is with all due respect, how many total employees do you have at HBCU Grow?
At HBCU Grow, only has volunteers at this
point. Volunteer.
When we do pay, when we do pay people to help with that, we pay African Americans.
I got it. And how about the board? The board, what's the racial composition of your board?
The board has Hold on a minute.
Here's the thing. Why are you coming up with that stat? The point I'm making is that as best you can, respect the culture of HBCUs as we look at the metrics in growing HBCUs. Sometimes that's a cultural conflict.
Oh, I understand. We have 11 board members, and the cultural ethnic composition of that, 9 of the 11 are African American.
Okay, that's helpful. Okay. Well, that's good. And because there's this tension in the black community between growing monetarily and financially and then staying true to your culture. And sometimes it results in non-action. And that's a cultural thing that black people have to get over. You can do good by way of the alums, and you can do well by way of the bottom line at the same time. They're not in conflict.
You can.
This is the alma mater of Hampton University, where my goddaughter, Logan Emily Page, has just enrolled. Stay tuned to the Gary Flowers Show. RejoiceRichmond.com, 101.3 FM, 990 AM. We'll be back in a few minutes.
Join the conversation. The Gary Flowers Show on Rejoice, 101.3 FM and 990 AM.
Welcome back to the Gary Flowers Show as we listen to the alma mater of Hampton University. We are talking to Jeanne Frazer, who is the co-founder of HBCU Grow and president of Vitalink. There is a conference coming up in November, which will concentrate on how to grow HBCUs both financially, from a marketing standpoint, and all things in between. And Sister Jeanne, once again, thank you so much for calling into the Gary Flowers Show this morning. You were about to talk about your sponsors and your board. Please do so.
Yes, thank you for having me today. One of the things I wanted to reach back out to Reggie, who called in earlier, and let him know that on our board, we do have a former director of athletics who had been at Delaware State University and Howard. So we do have our athletics represented on our advisory board, along with Grambling, University of District of Columbia, Jackson State, Shaw, and more. So our board is listed at hbcugrow.com, so people can check it out. Our two partners for this conference this year, HBCUs, are Livingstone College and Johnson C. Smith. Mm-hmm. And the sponsors who helped make this conference happen, who helped be able to pay for it so that HBCUs can get this information, are BDO, which BDO has stepped up and is going to be giving a $500 scholarship to one of the HBCUs in attendance for the conference, which is wonderful. Huron Consulting, Vitalink, Andy Sykes, and Universal Printing.
Excellent. Well, I wish you nothing but success for the conference. and your, moreover, let me say this, and much of my focus on the Gary Flowers Show, whereas we have a great colorful mosaic in this world and in this nation, my focus primarily is on the black tile of that mosaic, not to diminish any other colored tile, but that's my focus. And in so doing, I often implore white moderates who say that they care about fairness and justice and equality to get up off of the couch and do something. And you are one such who's done so through your institution, and you're making a difference. And I wanted to give you credit publicly for the work that you've done, not because you have a pitiful feeling toward the poor little HBCUs, but that you see them as a value added to, like I said, the American higher education landscape. And for that, I have deep respect for the work that you have done and are doing. So thank you, Sister Jeanne Frazer.
You're welcome. You know, the work is something that being able to own a business and be a woman who has her own business, it makes me be able to sleep well at night, that I know that I'm doing good. And that's something that's incredibly important to me.
And like I said before, there's no contention, if you will, between doing good and doing well. You can do good by the community, do good by HBCUs, and do well by bottom line as well. And so there's no conflict there. But I will say that if more whites of your stature would get involved and actually do more, as opposed to just kind of commenting from the sidelines, to actually get on the field, I think we'd have a better country and we'd have a better state of higher education.
I wholeheartedly agree with that.
Yeah.
The family coming together, it's a larger family, and that's the human family.
There it is.
You know,
I often say that we have one race, and that's the human race. And if you notice, I refer to Voices of the Village as brother or sister, because if we speak mm-hmm. it into an existence, then we create a familial context for human interaction. So if I refer to you as Sister Jeanne, I am going to treat you like a sister, more so than if I don't. And vice
versa.
I'm honored
by that.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I'm honored by that. Yeah.
So I look forward to the conference, and I look forward to working with you going forward. We'll help in any way here at the Gary Flowers Show in promoting the work that you all are
doing. We look forward to having your voice at the conference and having your intelligence and insight come to bear for the community.
Well, there it is. We have to, in this life, we have to move beyond. In the words of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., we have to move beyond analysis to action. If we remain in the miry muck of analysis, then we have the paralysis of analysis, as he often said. And so thank you for the work that you've done. I'm glad that you were on this morning to give information. But also, it's an example for those who haven't joined yet. And for my HBCU alums, look at the man or the woman in the mirror. How much are you giving back to your university? That is where we start. That's one end of the spectrum. The other end of the spectrum is, how do we more effectively lobby state legislatures to support and appropriate in a meaningful way the state schools? And then for the private institutions, how do we get either corporations such as yours, companies that do not want to undermine the mission of the school? The worst case scenario is a corporation who puts the CEO on the local black college board of regents, and that person doesn't even believe in HBCUs. The only reason they're there is because their corporation has given, you know, $100,000.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, and to, then that CEO gets to check the box. See, I do well by black people. I sit on the board of Skippy Dippy University. And it's an unholy alliance. And you see, I would dare say half of the board members across the country may fit into that category. And that's and that we have to do something about that.
For those who can't donate right away, volunteer your time. Help recruit high school students or mentor high school students to get them to an HBCU. Help lobby or talk to your representative, your congressman, congresswoman. Talk to them. There's a lot of things you can do if you can't give quite yet.
Exactly. And once again, give the connection to and contact information for HBCUgrow and the conference.
So the information line is through HBCUgrow.com. You can find out about our conference, our advisory board. We also have some awards, and voting is open until September 12th. And the public vote counts 50%, so it's important. If you want to support your HBCU, go to HBCUgrow.com and click on the link to vote. And if you want to attend the conference, information is there, and use the discount code FLOWERS if you would like a 20% discount off the conference.
As in the Gary Flowers Show. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Oh. And that's if you would like to email us. It's info@hbcugrow.com.
Okay. Fair enough. Well, thank you so much, Sister Jeanne. We're going to begin to close out now the Gary Flowers Show. But I want to thank you once again for coming on today. And we will be talking back and forth about what it looks like to participate in the conference going forward.
Wonderful.
All righty.
Well, thank you.
Be well
thank
today.
Thank you, Brother Gary.
Thank you.
You too.
And as we close out today, we play in the words of the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin, as she extols and covers Billie Holiday's song, God Bless the Child. As always, speak gently. Think deeply, give freely, work hard, laugh a lot, and be kind. And when you do so, you will give flowers to the people.
For the Bible said, and it still is news, Mama may have, Papa may have, God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. Well, the strong gets more, while the weak ones fade. Empty pockets don't ever make. Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless a child that can stand up anywhere and say, I've got my own.